there's something that comes up all the time when I'm with clients, and it's clients have ag, and what should I do with this ag? And right away in the beginning of the day, I'm looking at it like, I want to take as much of that ag and convert it to whitetail habitat as possible, because that's going to help the landowner. It's going to help the client. It's going to help you as the viewer. And there is no mistake about it. Ag is bad when it comes to whitetail, and don't shut this off. Listen to me. It is so true. Ag is very bad when it comes to whitetail. I've even seen advice. So if you have ag around, you don't need food plots. Hogwash. Don't believe it. Not true. Whatever percentage you can take back from ag, even if it's 2 acres out of 25 that's on your land, you're going to be better off as a whitetail habitat manager, as a whitetail hunter, as a herd manager, if you get rid of as much ag as you can. And I'm going to go through the reasons why, because there's several very good reasons why. Don't ever think that because you have ag on your land that it's a good thing. Now, ag around your land, I'll start. Around your land is a good thing, because that gives the deer that fourth and fifth feeding. Five feedings per day in a 24-hour period. I learned that from John Azoga long ago. I name them the first one, number them. The first one is in their bedding areas when they first get back in the morning. The second feeding around noon. The third feeding about an hour before dark, and then twice during the night. And ag is great because it represents number 4 and 5 of their five feedings in a 24-hour period. And what's great about that is it takes pressure off your own land. Keep them on your land. Give them that first, second, third feeding, and then send them off your land to the ag and let them feed on someone else's land all night. No different than if you're taking the deer that are on your land or around your land during the daylight hours, and you're sending them off to your neighbor's land on their food plots and on their food source that night, so they can consume their resources instead of yours, and that way you can make a lot more efficient parcel. Number one, ag is bad. Ag is bad for all these. But number one, ag is bad because it's too broad. You look at the ag around here. If it's all the same, if it's all in corn, if it's all in beans, even if it's in a mixture of corn, beans, and alfalfa around here in Southwest Wisconsin, whatever that mix is by you, it's too broad, meaning that deer can come in from anywhere around here. They can come in to an 80-acre field. They can come in at many, many different locations in that 80-acre field. So ag is broad. You don't have a definition of movement that way. They can come in anywhere, and for that, which bedding area they're using, which travel corridor, that's always changing. Ag is bad because it's too broad, it's nondescript, it's not going to give you that definition of movement. And a lot of these have to do with the definition of movement and your ability to actually create, attract, build a deer herd. And if you don't have a good deer herd, you're not going to have a good hunt. Not only is ag broad, but it's always changing. You know, around here, you can see portions that are plowed, you see portions that will be planted soon, you can see corn stubble. It's always changing. And for that, you can have ag on one side of your land, that's corn. Ag on the other side, that's beans. The bean portion might be great in the early season, and the corn portion might be great in November. Don't think that's a good thing, though. It makes your parcel extremely inefficient, that we'll talk about in a little bit, but ag is always changing. Sometimes it's plowed under. I went to a client the other day in Illinois, and the problem with their ag land was that it's picked, the corn was picked in November 5th, and it was actually plowed under on November 8th. So for that, then after November 8th, they have a bunch of plowed fields. The deer don't even want to run through them, walk through them, move through them, because it's that deep furrowed plowed field in November, gets muddy, and it's just prohibitive. It's hard for us to walk through, let alone deer. So it's always changing. You can't count on it. And when you can't count on the ag land because it's always changing, there's no way you're going to be able to count on building a good herd, let alone a good hunt. As it comes to deer habitat, ag is very low value. What I mean by that, it's random, it's always changing, but even the ag itself, you have beans that turn brown in September, in a lot of portions, a lot of areas of the country where there's a lot of beans, then once they turn brown, if there's beans everywhere, the deer just stop hitting them. So you could have a big piece of private land that has beans all the way around it and no deer October, November, and December, because once the beans turn brown, once they're picked in early October, there's absolutely no value. There's no cover value. There's no food value. If it's plowed under, you can't count on that value. And think about the power of a food plot. The power of a food plot in one location, 2 acres, 3 acres, 4 acres, can be worth 80 acres of ag land when it comes to food, because you're defining deer movement to that space. And as long as that food on your food plot lasts the entire season, then you're gonna out-pull, out-attract, and out-protect deer that are coming to your food plots on a small parcel than your neighbor that has 400 acres and is relying on ag. And that's what I see a lot of times. A landowner have a huge amount of acreage and they're relying on 80 acres of ag or 100 acres of ag to support their 200 acres of woods. Well, if that ag has no food on it, it has no cover on it, and if they're not working on the habitat in their woods, it's a recipe for an extremely poor parcel, even if it's 400, 500, 600 acres. I see those all the time, and I see them after a landowner's had them for 8 to 10 years and they want something different, they want something quality, and they understand that, boy, I just need to bite the bullet. We're gonna convert some of this ag, and I love that because I'm like a kid in a candy store because I know what their potential is going to be in the future when they get rid of that ag and they actually make some whitetail habitat improvements that relate to their land, relate to their hunt, and relate to their herd building ability and really put their herd building ability on steroids by getting rid of the ag because it is extremely low value. Think about the ever-changing food source, the broad food source, the lack of no cover. And if you think corn is great cover in November, think again. I see that in high pressure states, but corn is not great cover. Deer don't want to bed in corn and feed three times a day on corn. They can't. It's no different than acorns in the woods. They have to have diversity and variety. I read that deer will eat over 400 varieties of plants and shrubs, even eating dead fish on the shores of Lake Superior that dried out. They probably seek some type of protein level that's in that dried fish, but they eat just about anything. It's easier to list what they don't eat. But bottom line, deer do not want to be in corn all day. It's not only is it not great food source, not only do they need more diversity, not only do they need some high moisture content green in their diet during that time of the year, but the corn is bad cover, just like a bunch of switchgrass. You know, 30 acres of switchgrass is bad cover because there's no food in it. They have to feed in feedings 1 and 2 during the bedding hours. And if it's just pure corn, they have to leave that corn. They're only in that corn if they're forced to. A lot of times when I hear that deer are bedding largely in corn, like I used to see in the thumb area of Michigan back when the deer herds were 60 to 80 deer per square mile, in the thumb area near Cass City, Bad Axe in that area, this was back in the late 80s, they were in that corn then because there was so much pressure in the tiny little woodlots on flat land with hardly any cover all the way around that corn that they were forced into that corn. It's almost you feel sorry for the deer looking back at them. They didn't have a choice but to be in that corn, and they don't want to be in there. It is low quality on many levels. Because the ag land is low quality, it's broad, it doesn't offer definition and movement. You can't build a deer herd with just corn or just ag around you. You can't. A neighbor that has a high quality food plot system, just 5 to 10 acres, even 3 acres like we do around here, 2 1/4 acres, they're gonna outcompete you as far as it is for attracting deer during the daylight hours, offering them feedings 1 and 2 back in the woods, and that all important number 3 food source. Deer don't wanna be in that ag field in the afternoon if they don't have to be, if they have safe food plots adjacent. And that's why I think we outcompete a lot of the neighbors in the areas that we hunt, because we can have 2 1/4 acres of green food plot that is different than they get anywhere else. And if the neighbor is relying purely on ag, they're going to lose. It doesn't matter if they have 400 or 500 acres. They're not going to be able to build a good deer herd because they don't have that number 3 all important feeding of the day that they're attracting deer to, that deer want to go to. If you have safe green food, even if that includes a little bit of corn, you're offering that for the entire year. You're not plowing your corn down in November. You're not offering a food source like corn that only peaks the end of October, November, and is stagnant for August and September. You don't have beans that turn brown in September and the deer leave and they don't come back to in December if they're still there, if they're not plowed. There's a lot of ifs in there. It's always changing. So if you take control and you offer those food plots, you can outcompete a neighbor and draw deer from your neighbor's land, even if they have 400, 500, 600 acres and a bunch of ag. If you just have a few acres of food plot and you keep it protected and you have adjacent protected cover, then you're going to be the herd influencer in the neighborhood, even with 40 acres compared to your neighbors with 500 or 600 acres. I see it all the time. Believe it, don't rely on ag, and that's another reason not to. There's only 2 more points in this, so I'll get finished with this. Obviously, ag is bad. There's a lot of reason, but ag makes your small parcel, even if it's 500 acre parcel or 200, a 40, a 20 acre parcel, it makes it extremely inefficient. Because ag's always changing, then deer are gonna focus on one side of your property or the other. For example, a 40 acre parcel, let's say you have great bedding areas on the west side but there's a lot of ag on the east side that they're hitting at the moment. At the moment, meaning typically they're not hitting ag for the entire season. That one food source can't do that. Then what happens to that west side, those west side bedding areas? Deer don't want to go from that ag field, travel 440 yards across the back side, or 400 yards and 300 yards every single day to get to those good bedding areas when all the food's on the other side. They want to be a lot closer to that, so those bedding areas aren't used. Those food sources don't provide enough efficiency for your parcel because they're one-sided and they're always changing. You could have it plowed one year, standing the next. So those west side bedding areas, if there's east side food sources, they're not being used. Those stand locations aren't being used. Those travel corridors aren't being used. Those water holes and mock scrapes that you rely on for identification and for a quick stop right next to a bow stand aren't being used. They go from a roller coaster from one year to the next. Let alone if it goes fallow for a year, or if they're planting alfalfa and it's just turning into seed, they're just putting seed in the ground and putting a cover crop of oats and it's young. It's always changing. So not only are all your attractions not working, your stand locations not working, your travel corridors not working, but you can't afford with even 500 acres or 40 acres or 20 to only have half your property working at any one time. You just can't afford because it's always changing. I want a land where I dictate exactly where the deer are moving to every afternoon. I want to know where they're bedding. I want to know how they're traveling to get to that food source. I want to dictate where they're traveling. I want to dictate where they're stopping to make a mock scrape, where the water hole's at. Your habitat improvements have to have a purpose and they have to define movement. And if you have ag fields, you cannot do that. You might as well just hunt public land, because at least on public land, you could find a hidden remote section where deer are feeding on maybe a clear cut of 12 acres down in a hollow out on public land on 60,000 acres. And deer are moving across certain benches or saddles or ridge points through the woods where you can define movement. You know that does are bedding closer to that clear cut and bucks are bedding a lot further away. Then you can define movement, and if you get it remote enough, you don't have anyone else bothering you or getting in your way like neighbors would on private land. So a lot of times you can have a better definition of deer movement and a better hunt, a more predictable hunt on public land than you can if you're relying on ag land in a private setting, because your property is extremely inefficient. All your work that goes into providing stands, mock scrapes, water holes, bedding areas, travel corridors, native grass plantings, whatever it might be across your entire property, apple trees by stand locations, whatever it might be. If you're relying on ag land, you're basically throwing it all away for half the season, half the property. And if you don't establish that pattern of use with quality food plots in August and September and allow those deer in their fall patterns, because you could really care less where they're at in the summertime. It's always changing. Summertime does are here to stay typically. They'll stay in the same location, but mature bucks often are a mile, mile and a half away from the summertime versus the fall. And you want to have that those few select fall properties, that 5% property that I talk about or less, where you're the actual fall property in the neighborhood that attracts deer. And if you have ag land surrounding you and you do not have food plots, then you are not going to have that consistent attraction. You're not going to be able to build a herd, and your efficiency of your parcel is going to be extremely poor, because you're going to have large portions of your property that aren't working for you based on the whims of the farmer's rotation on your ag land. Very bad. Finally, ag land equals no food, no cover, no definition of movement. And if you can't define the deer movement on your property over a large scale, you can't define even how you access the land. You always have to have that foundation of food as your movement. It doesn't matter if you're hunting on public land, if you're hunting on private. The only way you're going to build a herd on private land is if you start defining that movement in August, September, you carry that out to January, and who cares where the deer go afterwards. That's how you're going to build a herd. You don't build a herd in April, May, June, July, August, September. You build a herd in October, November, December. Try not to be the one with all those mature bucks on random alfalfa and bean fields during the summertime, because you're not going to be the herd influencer. Yeah, you might get a crack at those in November during the rut, but if you have a rut-only parcel, you're not the herd influencer either. You're just a herd taker, meaning they come through on a certain bench, you sit in that one stand, you shoot a nice buck every year. You didn't build the herd. You didn't improve the herd. You didn't improve the sex ratios, the buck age structure. You can't even maintain the population in the area and that balance of population you need for the area if you're just relying on a rut movement. And there's nothing wrong with that. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, that's a fun hunt. There's some great stands out there where you can sit in a certain stand and shoot a rut buck every single year less definition, might not be your target buck. You just shoot a nice buck that goes by. Instead, I want you guys out there to be a true herd influencer. I want you to actually take a focused population all hunting season long, a population that you can mold sex ratios, buck age structure. If you need to shoot a bunch of does, you can. If you don't need to shoot a bunch of does because you're trying to build a herd, you don't have to. But bottom line, you're going to be that influencer. And if you are surrounded by ag and you're relying on ag, you're not putting out quality food plots that match the depth of your cover and everything that we talk about in my food plot playlist, in my advanced buck hunting structure strategies playlist, daylight buck hunting and daylight herd manipulation and improvement, those are all playlists of mine. If you're not using food plots on private land to define that daily movement, then for one, anybody that does it next to you and does it right will make you not see very many deer for the season. I have people say, well, I don't need food plots. Why don't you talk about not putting food plots on public land or on private land? It's because you're only going to experience a fraction of your potential. You might even have a great hunt because you're a rut hunter and you have that rut hunt, you shoot a big buck that comes through. I want to take way more control of that. If you just have great habitat and you don't have in cover and you don't have food, then you're only experiencing a fraction of what you can have if you actually planted food plots and you chose to take back your deer hunting, take back your herd, control your herd, define your herd, build your herd, be the herd influencer. You're not going to do it with ag. Really try to tap into the power of food plots. It's not even close, folks. I almost feel sorry for people. I see 500 acres, you know, we have ag lands. Where do you put my stands? Well, where's the ag field that year? Where's the rotation? Where's the corn that year? Where's the beans? Are you hunting early season or mid season? Is it plowed under in December? Because you might not even have deer on your property, even if it's 500 acres. So easy for a neighbor with 40 acres and good food plots to take advantage of a 500 acre parcel. I see it all the time. I help clients do it all the time. I help clients reverse the effects of relying on ag too much. Try those food plots this year. Try doing it right, watching the strategies on this channel, my food plot playlist, my food plot book, and you'll be on the right path to success this fall by actually being the herd influencer in the neighborhood. And you can't do that by relying on ag.